Hi to everyone. So thank you to the Max Network for the opportunity to present this work. This project has been developed in the group of Stefano Baroni in CISA since some years now, and is actually starting also from a question which arises from the application from the industrial world. Now, I didn't check the scientific value of these slides, but when we talk about dyes and food, there is a growing demand in the community connected to the risk that artificial dyes have shown exhibit. So these are just random figures I took from the internet. But anyway, the idea to move toward natural dyes instead of artificial one, it's still a good reason to a good motivation for this work. And yeah, I just show an example. So this is a pair of artificial and natural dyes. This is, for instance, these dyes, and this is a family of azo dyes. They are very common synthetic dyes. You can see that it's a very bright red. This dye is actually forbidden in US and in some country in European Union. While there is a natural alternative, which you can maybe not feel, but is slightly less bright. This was actually known since some year already, and is what is called cochineal, I think. I think I never pronounced this word in English, but anyway, it's took from insects, and it was used for fabrics as well, as is very common as a natural dye for food. So there are cases like this one where there are already natural alternatives, although we can imagine that the gamut of the color are not exactly correspondent to the artificial one. I just want to stress as well the structure that we have, and for many of these dyes, these are organic molecules, so we have an extended conjugation, for instance, but there are even more complicated things. We have metals, for instance, in these structures. We have water, which is embedded, probably, and so there is an increase of complexity whenever we move from something that is industrial and under complete control to something that comes from nature, and then it has its own environment and its own specific condition. So a very promising family of natural dyes is actually anthocyanin. So here you have the very general molecular structure of this. They express a series of colors in nature that we can find in many vegetables, but as well as in flowers. And they actually turns from red to purple to violet, depending on the substitution that we can find on the ring, so that are connected to the conjugated frame, and then of course also on the condition where these dyes are found. So here, as I don't know if you can read, but from the anthocyanin, which is a very large family, we can actually, by changing the substitution, we can derive several other derivative that has their own nomenclature, and it's very, there's a very complicated chemistry associated with that. When we talk about organic dye, we need to keep in mind some idea about the feature they have. So first, I already mentioned the electronic pi conjugated frame. It's of course the one that controls the electronic level, and so the fact that you have an absorption in the visible. That's what makes a dye. And then you have also, of course, a role played by the environment, which might be the solvent, so generally water, but speaking about natural product, we need to keep in mind the fact that generally there are functions that can be protonated and deprotonated, so acidity is also important. We have slow degrees of freedom, which turns into conformation. So for instance, looking at our anthocyanin, we know already that there are internal rotation that we expect to control the existence of conformers, so the minima of the conformational landscape. And then also there are, the system is all vibrating at room temperature. And these fluctuations also needs to be accounted. So the overall picture, which is the sum of these, at least of these features, is quite complex. And that's then that's the reason for which we need a computational protocol that would be robust and multi-scale, so that it needs, because it needs to accurately account for all these effects. Just a slide, probably a bit simple and trivial, but of course the color, if we aim to model the color, what we need is basically an accurate absorption spectrum. In fact, we know the process of the observation of color is dependent from a light source, which is in principle a white light source. We have an absorption spectrum that will result in a transmitting spectra and then in a color. I just want to mention that when we talk about color, we should also keep in mind that the expression of color is connected to a color space, which is not something so trivial, because depending on which is the medium which is rendering the color, and also subjective perception, it's all another interesting topic. So at the end, the meaning of this slide is just to say that if you want to accurately compute a color, we need to accurately compute absorption spectra for this kind of system. And that's what we aim to do. So I just introduced a bit the problem. So dye that are synthetic and the natural one. And now I try to introduce the protocol that was developed within the MAX project. And so the protocol for colors should actually account for all the things we mentioned that are typical of this system. So we should have an accurate screening of the conformational landscape. So this can be done at classical dynamical level, for instance. Then we have to focus on each of these of the most abundant species, so the conformers, and follow it at a higher level of theory. And so, for instance, perform ab initio molecular dynamics, which then needs to be took and used for the calculation of the optical absorption, which is can be done, for instance, at the level of TDDFT. And at the end, we need to average and have the color. So some part of this protocol were already developed, were already work developed in the laboratory in CISA, and now we are trying to apply in a coherent way all this protocol to a family of anthocyanin. So this is a workflow, and so it's just to put in another way what we just said. Remember that whenever we focus on which are the conformers, we then need to take each of it and go through the next steps, which will mean that for each of the conformation, we should then go through a specific molecular dynamics and a specific spectrum with results from each of the conformers, and then this would have to be averaged through some probabilities or population that we can obtain from the previous step. At the end, we will have the color. So let's start now to, then I will start now to go through the steps and apply it to the system we have studied, so anthocyanin. And basically, first, I already mentioned, but whenever we have a very feature conformational landscape, we need to be able to sample all the minima, because this one would be at room temperature, all relevant whenever they are at within the thermal energy range. And so sometimes we also need an unset sampling method, just to quickly mention this. For our system, which is this one, for instance, the internal degrees of freedom, the dihedrals that were featuring such a landscape, and so they were determining the conformers, are essentially three, which I put it here. And you can see, for instance, one is actually very important because it modulates the degree of conjugation between two of the ring on this part of the molecule and the third ring, the B ring, which is here. And so we expect this to be actually very important also for the optical properties. But already at the classical dynamic level, we can see that actually when we have well sampled the space along this variable, and so we can convert the probability to actually an energy distribution, a free energy distribution, we can see that we have already two big minima and actually four sub minima, which will point to different conformers. So when we move to actually the selection of the conformers, which is the following step, the idea is to find a very general method for finding this conformer, and for this we have adopted the clustering algorithm, which was developed in the group of Flaio and Sissa, and actually it's based on the density estimation over the relevant variable for our conformational space, which in this case are these three. And we can see that by applying this clustering algorithm, which will find actually the most dense region of the conformational space, we find a distribution of centers, so distribution of conformers, but we can see already that four of these are dominating. So these are the most abundant conformers, which are actually already split in terms of its theta. So we can see that each of the conformers actually correspond to a peak in the space of this variable. And also on another one, they are slightly off one respect to the other. So you can see that whenever we compute this on a 2D histogram, we can see that we have, okay, maybe you don't see very well, but we have four bubbles here, and these are corresponding to the main conformers, which are actually here, so which differs from the rotation of this conjugated ring B respect to the rest of the molecule, as well as for the position of the sugar down here. Now, for each of the conformers, suppose we focus on the first one, we would have to run an ab initio molecular dynamics, and this is actually done again on an explicit solvated box, where we add water, and it's run at the ab initio level. After we have this enough long dynamics, we can then compute the spectra. So what we will do, we will take a series of frames coming from this dynamic, and we will compute a TDDFT absorption spectra for each of these frames. So now this was meant to be a movie, but I didn't manage. So at the end, you can see we have collections of structure which are took at different times, and the corresponding spectra might be actually very different from one to each other. But at the end, the idea is that during the dynamics, of course, this will be averaged, and the final color for this conformation will come as an average of this time series spectra. Again, the same concept, so you can see that now this the color just represent the time of the simulation, and you can see how, or even if you don't see the detail qualitatively, you could see that it could be very spread in the nanometer space, the corresponding spectrum. This actually depends from the thermal fluctuation, the molecular vibration, the role of the solvent, so the fact that the hydrogen bond in this specific frame might be stronger or less strong. And here I also show this is just the ground state energy along the time, so, and the ground and excited state. So just to show that these are real time properties that evolve at room temperature somehow. And So for each of the conformer, we would have then an average spectrum, which I put it here in thick line. And then at the end, what we need to remind, we have a workflow, we need to take each of these and average to the final spectrum, get a color. So this is what it looks like, for instance, for one of the species. So we have the four conformers, which are colored here, correspond to these four spectra, and then they are averaged to give this average spectrum, and then this color, which is corresponding to the one shown here. So this class of molecules, as we know, they are in the colors of purple or pink. But I will come back on these systems a bit later. Just let me, as a sort of first conclusion, draw which are the critical points of this, which is we have to first identify what are the chemical species we are interested in. And this is not that trivial, because when we have this system, we might have chemical equilibrium and chemical reaction going on. We need also to keep an eye, of course, on the sampling. So at the level of conformation and at the level of the dynamics, the tiled motion of the nuclei. Not as last, the environment is also important. So the way we model the solvent, explicit or implicit, it's also an important aspect. I will now quickly, I don't have a lot of time, but I will quickly show some more application on the same molecular system, but I will just show a couple of information more. So these are the molecular structure that are relevant, and I just want to stress that is, even though I plotted here the single structure, the structure actually undergoes to acid-base chemistry, and so depending on the pH, we have that one or more deprotonation sites actually concur for the equilibrium species at that pH. And so let me just quickly step toward the hand and show that by applying this protocol and with a computational effort that was quite large, because we had several species that have to be that have to pass through the protocol that I shown you, and for each of these we have different conformers. So you can see probably this here quickly, yes. So you can see this is a species where the protonated in four. We have these four conformers that I showed you here, which are more or less the same for all system, but for each of these we will have to follow the dynamics on ab initio, and then to have the spectrum, which are then computed per conformer and then averaged. So this is the results, for instance, for this system. And then just very quickly, I want to show that the system, this class of molecule, this anthocyanin, actually can be much more interesting when we start to add metals, or the complexity of the structure start to increase by adding other conjugated moieties that are substituted on the main ring. And this is some work we are doing on metals and on compigmented system, where you have the chain that connect to the other aromatic moieties are very much important to modulate the optical properties, because the pi stacking is one of the ingredients that will definitely produce larger number of low-lying excitation and also an overall redshift. So I don't have the time to focus to enter the detail here, but there's a lot one can do, and actually, especially for complex system, it's good to have a protocol that will, as more robust as possible, that will give color given the input structures. And so I just finish here. I thanks the funding and this network for this opportunity, and a group of Baroni and people working on this project, Mariam, Sara, and Marta, which is now in Padova. Thank you very much.